Hallo, schönen guten Tag. Hi, schön, dass ihr wieder da seid bei Africa Outlook. Hi, everybody. Nice to see you. You see this poster here? Black History Month is back in town in Hamburg in its 19th year. 19 Jahre Black History Month. Und darüber wollen wir ein bisschen erzählen heute. Ich habe drei tolle Gäste. Die organisatorische Mensch hinter diese ganze tolle Sachen, Nigel Asher, ist da. My friend and historian, visual artist, poet, Maceo is here. How you doing, baby?
Fine.
And we have, for the first time, a real professional American football coach, Mike Scholars. Welcome. Nice to
Hello, Paula.
see you. You're just meeting Nigel and Maceo for the first time. How do you like Germany? I mean, you're in Lübeck. You're coaching, your head coach for the Seals, the professional, semi-professional football team Seals. How does it feel to be in Germany?
This is actually my third assignment in Germany, but this is my first time to actually be a resident of Germany. Before, I commuted from Luxembourg in the towns of Trier and Koblenz. But fantastic, fantastic, and particularly this section of Germany, because the culture is so dominant here and significant in the history of this country.
So, das Land ist fantastisch für dich. Du warst in Luxemburg erstmal und erstmal so weit, so gut. So, wir sind hier, we're here, and we're people of African descent on the scent right here. How do you feel about being, I think you're probably the first coach with African descent for the Seals, is that correct?
Yes. Yes, this is true.
Any challenges?
And there's different challenges with each assignment, but this is a sensitive area in the sport of American football in Europe in general. But the players have presented no particular challenge for me personally, but I do know that culturally it's a different thing for them to experience. But since I have so much experience doing this, I think it's a pretty easy transition for them. But yes, there are some stereotypes that one
So,
has to come over.
ein paar Herausforderungen als erster schwarzer Profi-Coach für Football hier. Aber das kriegst du schon hin mit all deinen Erfahrungen, with all of your experience, you work it out. Ja, ich freue mich, dass du hier bist. I'm glad that you're here today, weil du hast eine ziemlich anders Erziehung, als ich es hatte. Ich war hauptsächlich in einer Stadt, wo die meisten Leute mit afrikanischer Herkunft waren, und du kommst von einer Stadt, wo du eigentlich in der Minderheit warst. You come from a town where you were one of the few people of African descent. And so, how was that growing up? And how did you keep your self-worth as a person of African descent in America, but you were one of the few in a predominantly white community?
Yeah, well, that's kind of funny. I did actually grew up in a town called White Settlement, Texas.
White
So,
Settlement. Wie
and
kann man das übersetzen?
it's
Weiße Siedlung, Texas. Er ist in einer Stadt aufgewachsen. Weiße Siedlung, ja, White
it
Settlement.
literally was that. But
Okay.
for me, it was a through under the cloak of success in sports. When you have success in anything at a young age, you don't experience some of the same type of prejudices and things like that that people who are just have a normal life do.
Also, du meinst, weil du also bekannt warst als Sportler, hattest du ein bisschen leichter Leben als die in Anführungsstrichen normalen Leute, die nicht dieses Ruhm hatten, okay?
So on one level, it was fantastic, but you can't escape racism. I think I mentioned before in grade 10, we had the KKK, the Ku Klux Klan. They burned a 10-foot cross in our front yard because we were the only black family in the town. And we found out later that the people who were leading this, one black person did something wrong to them. Since we were the only black, they knew it wasn't us, but since we were the only black people in town, we took
The brunt of the problem. So,
Yes.
weil eine andere Familie mit schwarzer Herkunft irgendwas gemacht haben, die Ku Klux Klan haben ein 10-Foot-hoch Kreuz vor euer Haus brennen lassen. Und ja, das war bestimmt erschreckend für dich. That was probably pretty scary.
Yeah, for a 10th grader it was,
Zehnte Klasse, und
Yeah,
dann hast du das so erlebt.
it was,
Wie war es für dich mit Black History Month? Also, wie könntest du in dein Schwarzsein stolz sein? How could you stay true to your blackness, so to say, living later in your years with being, like I said, mostly with predominantly white people. Your parents were probably a strong influence on you for your history to keep you proud of who you are.
Yes, I mean, we were taught at a very young age to have self-respect, and it goes without saying, you know, we were also taught that race did not matter. My mother in particular, she prepared us to succeed in a colorless world. And so I never had a problem assimilating, whether it be Sweden, Denmark, Germany, the Netherlands, Belgium, France.
Du bist ein bisschen bescheiden. Also ich weiß, dass sehr intelligent ist. Hat eine sehr hohe IQ. EQ, wie sagt man das? Ja? IQ, sagt man auch. Und ist extra zu den Anführungsstrichen bessere Schule geschult worden. Er hat die Gelegenheit, sich auszubilden. And away from the not so rich or so educated people. So you had more an advantage, so you were more open to the other cultures and you didn't really have a problem with racism. Richtig, nicht richtig ein Problem damit. Deine Eltern haben dich so farblos sozusagen erzogen, in dass jeder Mensch ist gleich und Respekt vor allen.
Absolute. And that's one of the fascinating things I've learned about from coaching in Germany previously, and now I'm firsthand by actually living here, is that the culture is I have this philosophy of true unity equals true empowerment, and the Germans I think they're so successful in American football. The country is the three-time defending European champions in American football, the German national team. I think it's because they understand the concept of unity and how, you know, if you bond together, you know, you can overcome almost any obstacle.
Ja, and, irgendwie warst du für Deutschland erschaffen mit so ein Motto für Leben, true.
Unity equals true empowerment.
True, somebody, wahre Zusammenhalten.
Ja,
gleich.
Zusammenhalt. Gleich. Ja. Wahrer Zusammenhalt zielt ab, ja, auf Empowerment, sagen wir auch auf Deutsch. Das ist ein Anglizismus, dafür gibt es eigentlich keine Übersetzung. Also man kann,
Manu, na, was er alles da sagt, das ist das dir neu? Also für dich, wie war deine Zeit aus Kind her, aus Frau, also hauptsächlich you connect yourself with South Africa, you have a long history of different types of, we're all mixed up anyway, anybody that's not scurple black like his pants has different background cultures, but I consider you one of a living historian. You really look into the history of things and why people see the things the way that they do. He seems to be a bit protected, I would say, as an American. Even though you dealt with the Ku Klux Klan cross in front of you, you were still raised with a strong sense of self and a strong sense of respect for yourself and a strong belief that unity of all the races means that it's empowered. Did you have this same upbringing?
Also ich muss als erstes sagen, ich bin bei meinen Großeltern aufgewachsen und ich war in meiner Familie, also ich bin ja hier in Deutschland aufgewachsen, kannte jetzt meine südafrikanische Familie abgesehen von meinem Vater nicht. Ich habe meinen Vater aber selbst immer als also sehr groß, 1,95 Meter stolzen schwarzen Mann mit Anzug und Mercedes. Also es kam für mich viel später wahrzunehmen, dass schwarze Menschen unterdrückt sind. Weil wenn man meinen Vater sah, und man kennt viele dieser schwarzen, eleganten Männer, gut angezogen, schicke Autos, also klar stimmt das vom System, aber die Haltung ist nicht die eines unterwürfigen Menschen. Und ich bin in meiner Familie von Anfang an aufgewachsen als Schwarze. Also ich hatte mit 4 Jahren Ballettunterricht. Der Traum meiner Großmutter war, dass ich die erste schwarze Prima Ballerina werde, der Hamburger Staatsoper. Ja, ich habe dann aber später mit Ballett aufgehört. Meine Großeltern kannten sich da nicht gut aus, aber zum Beispiel, die hatten zwei, unter all ihren Schallplatten auch zwei Schwarze, das eine war von Louis Armstrong an einem Buben und mein Großvater hat gesagt, beste Trompeter der Welt. Dann eins von Mahalia Jackson, beste Sängerin der Welt. War Josephine Baker im Fernsehen, beste Tänzerin der Welt. Muhammad Ali, beste Boxer. Also ich
Even
bin immer
you
damit
were
aufgewachsen.
Raised by your German grandparents, your dad was in a suit and tie, had his Mercedes, so you didn't really feel like he was in the minority or something, or inferior to anyone. So you had a strong sense of blackness just by looking at your 2 meter tall father. And Josephine Baker on TV, your grandparents supported that best dancer of the world, Mahalia Jackson, and Louis Armstrong. So you had a strong sense of your blackness. But your skin color was, of course, a little bit browner than anyone else. But were you still pretty much easy in your childhood growing up?
Nein, also das war also in der Familie, es gab einen großen Unterschied, also drin in der Wohnung, also mit meiner Familie und draußen vor der Tür. Meine Großmutter hat meinen Schulbesuch ganz lange hinausgezögert, also bis 7, da musste sie ja, Schulpflicht. Sie wollte nicht, dass ich in den Kindergarten gehe, sie hat sehr ausgewählt, also das war also auch so ein Schutz. Und ich kann mich erinnern, ich glaube, ich habe das erste Mal dieses berühmt-berüchtigte N-Wort, glaube ich, ich war 4 oder 5, sagte das ein Junge zu mir, ich habe ihn dann geschubst, ich wusste gar nicht, was das heißt. Ich habe das meiner Großmutter erzählt und wir sind dann an den Strand gefahren, an die Ostsee, Timmendorfer Strand. Und meine Großmutter hat mich an die Hand genommen, sie hat gesagt, guck mal, die liegen alle in der Sonne, weil sie aussehen wollen wie du.
Okay,
aber
so
sie
a very
rot.
Strong yeah. turning point in your life is when someone said to you the N-word and your grandmother said, look, let me show you something. I'll take you to the beach. Everybody's lying out here in the sun trying to look like you.
Yeah.
So that must have meant something very strong for you.
Ja, es war vielleicht gar nicht so gut, weil ich habe mich da ein bisschen überlegen gefühlt, also Aha. Special German.
Oh, you, okay.
ja. mm-hmm. Und dann später, als ich gelernt habe in der Schule, so mit 14 Teenager, da kam das dann anders. Und dann haben wir auch über Amerika allgemein gelernt. Wir haben irgendwie nur gelernt, dass die Schwarzen in Amerika natürlich tolle Musik machen und gut sind im Sport, aber dass sie alle Sklaven waren. Dass das alles, also
so
da fing das an.
That most of the Americans learned, basically, Mike, what she's saying, is that later when she was a teenager, she went to school and they learned a bit about American history, but the people of African descent were good musicians and right. good athletes, mm-hmm. but not necessarily in anything else. So right. this is why we're talking today with Black History Month, the need or the, mm. We don't like that word need, but the opportunities that are there to continue that people of African descent learn about their history and also the mainly the people of European descent so they understand too that we have a rich history and mm-hmm. it's nothing to be afraid of or too proud of, but rather to accept the fact that we all contributed to the success of our planet, so to say. I wanted to let Nigel Asher get a word in here.
Yes.
Yeah, you've been doing Black History Month for, what is it, 19 years now? Next year's the big 20. Mm-hmm. And you were born in England, you have Jamaican roots in you, you've spent a lot of time in Germany and Hamburg, and you're one of the main reasons why cultural events are happening in Hamburg, especially Black History Month. This year is February.
Okay.
Yeah. Tell me
I didn't really start Black History Month in Hamburg. It was an American singer who did.
But I'm just saying in Hamburg, but because we're celebrating, what, 110 years. It started in the late 1920s in America. It started out as Black History Day. Mm. I think it was W.E.B. Du Bois and a couple of other strong leaders of American descent who decided that we needed at least a day, and then it became a week, and there's been over 100 years of celebrations. But I meant specifically in Hamburg, Germany, is almost 20 years where you've perpetuated this celebration. I think it's wonderful.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it feels good, and the program has been going on regularly. Sometimes it's a bit bigger, and sometimes it's just a few events. I think you wanted me to speak in German.
Ich denke, ja.
Kann ich auch machen, kein Problem. Also es gibt verschiedene, die Größe des Black History Month ist über die Jahre verschieden gewesen. Und dieses Jahr haben wir 8 Events, aber manchmal waren es auch schon über 20 Events, je nachdem wie der Input und das Team ist.
Yeah, it's right now you have at least 8 events. This year is, I think, a little less, and next year you're going to make a big 20 years. What I wanted to say was when it started almost 20 years ago, it was often very American. When Cynthia Utterbach started, it was because that's where she came from. It was very American. What I really appreciate what you've done, Nigel, you try to put as many cultures as possible. You put in the African connection, where there's a lot of people of African descent, African countries. Then you have the Latin connection.
Right. Yeah. It was like that because I think in Hamburg anyway, the I'll switch it to English again.
It's okay. No problem.
Also in Hamburg ist die Gesellschaft ja so multikulturell. Es gibt so viele verschiedene schwarze Leute, die aus verschiedenen Regionen stammen. Und deswegen ist in Hamburg das auch so, hat sich so entwickelt, dass ich es wichtig fand, die Leute zusammenzubringen. Und Black History Month ist natürlich dazu da, zu informieren auch über Geschichte und verschiedene Dinge, wie andere kulturelle Sachen von verschiedenen Regionen. Aber es ist auch wichtig, eine Plattform zu sein, um die Leute eben, dass die Leute sich erstmal individuell präsentieren können. Es gibt ja viele Leute, die irgendwas machen in professioneller Art oder nur eine Organisation haben, die sie in ihrer Freizeit betreiben oder so. Aber es ist wichtig, dass die Leute sich kennenlernen und networken. Und so habe ich, das war so der Hintergrund, weswegen ich das auch immer weitergemacht habe. Und es gibt ja Leute, die sich nur einmal im Jahr da treffen.
This is a very important point. I know you're almost a one-man band. Sometimes you have a bigger group of people that help you organize, but basically you're the man. Hey, Hamburg, this is the man who makes sure that sometimes, as you just said, sometimes, just once a year, everybody knows that Black History Month is happening. They just look around for posters. Where is it this year? And you make sure that the people can network. And especially whether it's an artist or an organization or whatever it is, that they can present something that is culturally and historically for and from people of African descent. Mm-hmm. You have poetry night. Example, Maceo will be there again. Mm-hmm. She's one of our Stamm wonderful guests.
Imma dabei.
Imma, she's such an amazing improvisational poet also. She thinks about, she's a visual artist, also a painter. How did you, your first experience with the poetry, did someone come to you? And what is the resonance of how that works?
Sie sagt, sie kam zu mir.
Okay.
Ja, das ist gut möglich. Ich kann mich gar nicht mehr so richtig erinnern, aber es ist auf jeden Fall, war sie seit Anfang an dabei und ich glaube, sie war bis jetzt immer dabei. Mhm. Und dadurch, das war so ein Erfolg am Anfang schon. Und es ist eigentlich so eine Night, wo die Leute waren, das war ein kleines Highlight immer im Black History Month, weil die Leute das so interessant finden. Es gibt so viele verschiedene Poetesses, richtig? und jeder hat seinen eigenen Stil oder ihren eigenen Stil. Und deswegen ist es auch immer das Highlight so dabei.
Und wo ist das dieses Mal?
Das ist diesmal im Kulturhaus 73. Location wechselt oft. Es war früher im Timbuktu mal oder auch anderen Locations.
So das ist der 28. Februar.
Yeah.
Poetry Night ist ein Samstag. Und es kostet nur 4 Euro. You really hold the cost down just to cover maybe flyers or transportation for some of the people. Nadja, we were just talking about Poetry Night and how all these activities expanded from just music back in the day to Afro Connection. You have Afro Talk, you have the Youth Night. And luckily, because you were a one-man band back in the day, Maceo came to you and said, hey, we should do a Poetry Night. And you were the first artist that came as a poet.
Ja, also das war so, dass an diesen Nachmittagen, diesen Familiennachmittagen sonntags und habe ich gedacht, okay, hier ist so ein Rahmen, wo ich auch Poetry machen kann. Ich komme eigentlich aus der Frauenszene, wo ich auch immer viel Support hatte. Mhm. Und das war aber immer sehr laut, weil das war nachmittags, die Leute wollen Musik, viele Kinder. Yeah. Und dann habe ich zu Nadja gesagt, oh Mensch, können wir nicht mal so einen extra Poetry-Abend? Aber ich kann das gar nicht organisieren, aber du kannst das, ja? Und er hat das sofort dann gemacht.
Super, ja, aber damals, because back in the, it was sometimes at different venues, and it was a Sunday afternoon, say from 3 o'clock in the afternoon, so the whole family would come. And back 19 years ago in Dennis Swing Club, not very big, only 50 people could get in there. One corner was for the kids, brought the crayons, the stage, the performers would be there. Cynthia baked the cupcakes and fried the chicken and had a slide projector. Mm-hmm. And now Nigel's taking it to one in the university. There might be a talk there. In Haus 73 is the Poetry Night. At different places, you might have parties for the young people or talks for the young people. So Wonderful. I see also that you invited a young, a new but older friend of ours, Marie Neyar, is going to talk about her book. Now for you, Mike, she is one of the only living survivors of the Holocaust here, an Afro-German who was raised in a very scandalous area in Hamburg and has a very interesting background. And she's coming and she's going to read some of her book, Mach nicht so traurige Augen, weil du ein Nägelein bist. When and where is that? And wie sieht das so denn aus?
Ja, das ist am 25. Februar in der Buchhandlung Servus. Das ist am Hafen, Landungsbrücken. Und ja, das ist eigentlich ein Event, das ist so eine Kooperation mit Chris Kasama hat das auch organisiert. Und ja, das ist, Marie hat das Buch ja schon vor einigen Jahren jetzt rausgebracht. Aber es ist trotzdem immer ja, interessant, also über sie zu hören, auch mit ihr zu sprechen. Sie wird ja auch nach der Lesung noch ein bisschen da sein,
dass, oh, das ist gut,
dass Leute ein paar Fragen stellen können oder einfach so ins Gespräch kommen können.
Ja, aber viele wissen nicht, dass sie da ist. A lot of people don't realize there is a, she must be almost 85 now.
Ja.
And she ice skated until for a few years ago. And her grandmother, her German grandmother, raised her. Her grandmother was married to a black man who was murdered. He had his own pub in Riga. And then her mother, who was a result of this mixed marriage, didn't really want Marie. So Marie was raised by her grandmother near Davidswache in Hamburg. And as I read the book, it's just a wonderful, amazing story. And she had three angels, her teachers, the doctor, and the neighborhood policemen. They were very tolerant because her grandmother would like, I hate Hitler, you know, whatever. And Marie would come home and have to say, well, we learned this new song today. And it was in the Hitler regime times, and her grandmother didn't want to hear it. You know, the teacher was tolerant. And when you're a child that is sick, when you were a person of African descent, they would sterilize you. Damals, wenn man schwarz war, wenn man krank wird und so ein Arzt geht, 100% sterilisiert. Und noch Schlimmeres. Yeah. Also, sehr interessanter Tag mit Marie Neyar bei der Lesung dabei. Es gibt ein Session für Fußball, a Workshop. Aber für mich interessiert mich auch für die Jugendlichen, ist eine Talk.
Ja, wie es ist auch das? Eigentlich eine, Teil einer Lesung. Und ist das Buch von Anne Chebo. Sie hat ein Buch geschrieben, das heißt Anleitung zum Schwarzsein. Und ja, das ist für Jugendliche. Und da wird ein bisschen darüber gesprochen, ja, wie man sich zum Beispiel verhält, bei, ja, wenn rassistische Witze gemacht werden von Freunden. Und eigentlich verschiedene Situationen, in die schwarze Jugendliche sich vielleicht finden und wie sie damit umgehen können.
Very good. This is a talk over a book that was written. It's like instructions to be black, rawly translated. How do you behave if somebody comes up to you and says a certain thing? What is racist? Is the question, where do you come from, racist? How often after after so many years of being in Germany, speaking almost perfect German, or at least being able to express myself and what I want, people still ask me, where are you from? Why are you here? When are you going back? And this is good because these children can talk about it and learn how to, the best way to behave. How do they react to this instead of getting aggressive or angry or hurt? And which words are politically correct now and why? This sounds very, very good. Instructions on how to be black at Trockendock on Friday the 6th. Right. So they can just kind of Google you by Black History Month if they want to find out where anything is going.
Yeah, and this location, Trockendock, is also, it has regular activities, different kind of activities. And there's quite a few black youth who know this place and who go there regularly.
How do you think you're upbringing might have changed at all, Mike, if you had something like this, you know, in your area? Do you think it was necessary, or do you think it would have changed anything?
Well, I grew up in White Settlement, Texas, but Maybe a 5-minute drive away was Fort Worth, Texas, which is, and I had cousins live there. And
predominantly black, just was, across the tracks.
So I got reality, you know. Hey, and actually, one thing that I mentioned earlier is kind of funny. Nigel made me think of it. You know, I was kind of in a cocoon because of the sports success, but my mother helped me stay in touch with reality. She never saw me play American football. She didn't want to come see me play because she didn't want to see anyone hit her son. And so she refused to see me play for years. And then finally, when I was in grade like 11, I started getting letters sent to the house from universities that were offering me scholarship to come play university football. And then she finally said, okay, I should go see what the fuss is about. So she and my aunt attended my first game, even though I had been playing for 6 years. First time she's ever saw me. And she came into the stadium, and because she'd never seen a game, no one of the fans, they knew who, no one knew who she was. So she came into the game, and I scored a long touchdown. And as she was sitting down, and she was like a very prominent leader in the town was screaming. He was literally screaming, that
N-word.
Nigger, that N-word, that N-word, show can't run. That N-word, show can run. He was just screaming that he can run like that. And then my mom stood up in front of everyone, and she said, that's not a N-word, that's my son. And then it's like,
but did she not want to go see you to get hit because of your blackness or because just of your of
just
being
just because
a son?
Of her being a mom.
Okay, this shortly translated. So deine Mutter hat seit für 6 Jahren dein Fußballspielen nicht erlebt,
it's,
weil sie wollte nicht sehen, dass ihr Sohn sich verletzt.
It's a contact sport.
Ja, na klar. Aber das erste Mal endlich, wenn du Universität-Level gespielt hast, dann kommst du mit long run, tolle Touchdown und eine weiße Bekannte hat gesagt, hilf mir dabei, wie sagen wir, look at that nigger run, that nigger sure can run.
Right.
Und deine Mom hat gesagt, das ist nicht mein, das ist kein Nigger, das ist mein Sohn. Wie hat sie dich dabei gefühlt? How did she feel about that?
Well,
and how did she, did you talk about it later?
Yes, she did. She felt shocked because that same man had had me spend a night at his home many times with his son. His son was a teammate, so she thought that he spoke the word, and he was. He to see some racism is it was not driven by hate. I think the individual didn't hate me. It was just that was his culture. He, you know, his whole life, that's what they called...
We can have a long discussion about that, right, Manu? What's the, that's his subliminal. Also das everybody knows that this word is the unspeakable word.
Yes.
That, let me just say this, and this is why we're discussing. And you can, well, I invite you back again. and for me, of course, everybody who talked with me long enough about Black History Month, I love that it's there. I was born and raised with Black History Month at America. I'm glad that we did it here. But I cannot wait for the day when it's not necessary. Ich freue mich auf den Tag, wenn sowas nicht nötig ist. Wie ist es denn jetzt in Deutschland, in Hamburg? Meinst du, dass manchmal die überwiegend Deutsche denken, ach, ich hasse die Schwarze Leute nicht, aber das ist ganz, ist okay, Nigger zu sagen, wenn, na? I just wanted to ask Manu, what do you think about that?
Ich glaube nicht. Also ich kann auch nicht für ganz Deutschland sprechen. Ich kenne ganz Deutschland zu wenig, weil alles, was wir auch beurteilen in Ländern, ist aus unserer Erfahrung, manchmal auch eine regionale Erfahrung. Woanders kann es anders
Hamburg,
sein.
Then?
Aber in Hamburg ist es so, ich meine, Hamburg ist eine alte Kaufmannsstadt. Wir unterstanden nie am König oder Fürsten. Und die Kaufmannsmentalität ist so, wenn wir von der Qualität überzeugt sind als Hanseaten, dann wollen wir das. Das heißt, wenn es die Lebensqualität auch verbessert, sinnvoller ist, andere Begriffe anzunehmen, habe ich gemerkt, dann lernen die überwiegenden Leute sehr schnell, also die Standard-Deutsch-Aussehenden. Wenn es mehr Sinn macht. Ich habe zum Beispiel, als damals der Begriff Afrodeutsch geprägt wurde, kommt auch von einer afroamerikanischen Feministin angeregt, Audre Lorde, und Frauen aus Berlin. Das war so ein Begriff, wo man sagt, eine Selbstbezeichnung, eine die muss da sein. Das haben sehr viele weiße Deutsche schnell angenommen, schneller als vielleicht andere schwarze Leute mit einem anderen Background, die sich dagegen gewehrt haben. Das heißt also, wenn die Qualität da ist oder auch auf dem Black History Month, es geht, das ist das Thema, Aber alle Leute kommen. Es kommen auch Leute aus Berlin, wenn dort der Black History Month nicht richtig stattfindet, dann kommen Leute aus Berlin. Du siehst alle möglichen Leute und bei vielen Leuten müsste man vielleicht dreimal raten, ob sie eventuell, man kann einen afrikanischen Ursprung nie ausschließen, aber auch Leute, die null, in keinster Weise, wo man das sieht, die kommen, weil es einfach toll ist und es eine Qualität ist. Und das sollen Leute auch sehen. Deswegen finde ich schön, dass es das gibt. Und ja, Afrokultura, das ist jetzt so mein Begriff, weil da alle Kontinente von vier verschiedenen Kontinenten, was da an Qualität auch steckt, ob das im sportlichen Bereich ist, im künstlerischen Bereich. Wir sind ja nicht alle geboren und können einfach singen, wie einige Leute denken. Das ist viel Arbeit, Entertainment. Und diese Qualität wird von allen Menschen geschätzt. Das ist das Tolle, dass Black History Month einfach eine Plattform ist, die auch zeigt, wir sind nicht nur oder waren irgendwie arm und traumatisierte Sklaven.
We weren't just what the history of Americans have taught. We weren't just slaves. And then, it's a good thing that the music was used as a hidden information to tell it, but that's part of the story is not told. But that Black History Month is an opportunity to show the part that people of African descent have taken in developing the world that we have. And what she said, what I thought was also wonderful, is that Germany didn't have kings and queens that kind of way.
Hamburg,
a Hanseatic Stadt. Mm-hmm. And they learn very, very quickly. They get it very, very quickly.
Merchants.
Yes.
It's good business too if you have quality, fantastic.
But actually, it's the same in America, but that they realize that black people also buy deodorant and food and they can, make money off of it. But I think my question is still, even though they don't see anything like that and the quality is shown in Black History Month, as you said, people come from all over to be here. The mentality of the Europeans in Hamburg, in your opinion, do you think that they still see black people as, still inferior to them, whereas more in America is like that, that this prominent white guy in America thought that he could say, ooh, look at that and run. You know what I mean? Just 1 second, you're coming.
Yeah.
But in Hamburg, I think that they're more...
Ja, aber wir haben jetzt das Jahr 2014. Ich meine, meine Erfahrungen, also die 80er Jahre waren auch eine, es wächst ja auch eine neue... Generationen heran. Es wachsen hier schwarze Kids auf, weiße Kids, für die es normal ist, mit schwarzen Kids in die Schule zu gehen, mit denen befreundet sein.
Yeah.
Türkische Kids, die sich manchmal dazwischen sehen. Also in Berlin gibt es zum Beispiel viele türkisch-deutsche Kids, die nennen sich POC, People of Color. Ja. Und das ist gemeinsam, mit Leuten aufzuwachsen. Also für die sind die Namen normal für unsere Kinder. Wir hören manchmal Namen und denken, wie spricht man das aus, weil sie nicht Deutsch oder Englisch sind. Für unsere Kinder ist das anders. Ich glaube einfach, es kommt drauf an, wo du bist. Natürlich, wenn du auf der Bühne bist oder wie gesagt in der Sportstadium, Center, aber wo du bist. Aber natürlich ist es auch immer noch so, zum Beispiel mit den Locations. Es gibt nicht viele Locations, die vielleicht also von Menschen mit afrikanischen, also mit Background, die ihnen gehören. Die also sagen können, das stelle ich zur Verfügung. Also es kommt darauf an, wo es ist. Weil nachher geht es natürlich wieder auch um Macht und Hierarchie. Das ist was anderes. Also es kommt darauf an, in welcher Position du dich befindest als schwarzer Mensch. Es ist ja auch ein Unterschied, ob wir sind hier, wir sind lange hier, wir können uns hier frei bewegen. Andere sind Flüchtlinge.
That is true. It just depends on your situation, where you are. There has been people of African descent that have been born here, and so they're just as German as anyone else. They're connecting more with each other. They call themselves people of,
Also rechtlich, sozial.
Of course, rechtlich. They're born here and they have the rights to everything. Beautifully said. I'm so glad that you cleared that, since there's no way I can add to that or even.
But perhaps, I don't know if you have to translate.
No, not everything. Okay. No, because most of the people speak German here.
Okay.
Maybe he will touch on some of that. You wanted to say something?
Well, back to what I said earlier, when the prominent person said that, he said that under the assumption that he was like it was 90% of the time there, an all-white audience. Mm-hmm. He didn't know that my mom was there because she had never attended.
But that doesn't make it any more right.
No, it's just like I had a I have a friend who's Asian and she's a professional comedian. And one of her favorite jokes is she says, you know, I used to date outside of my race, white guy, black guy, but now I date an Asian guy. And she goes, the best part about dating an Asian guy is that when we're together alone, we can tell racist jokes. Uh-huh. So I think he kind of, like people when they're, when you're by yourself, you know, we can, what do we,
but this
we
is,
met,
but this
we
is were, one thing that we talk about in Black History Month too. Just the fact is, one wants to be more transparent just because, I mean, I'm not going to make any stupid racial jokes about anybody,
right,
whether they're in present or not.
Right.
But that's okay. Hopefully that's
right
in the past and
no,
things like that don't
yeah
happen again.
I understand what you're saying there, mm-hmm, but it's just like when people are alone in their home.
Yeah.
You know, you do, like if you're alone with your like race mate, maybe
but
you say things.
But you were standing there as the black person running. Now, if that was okay, that you weren't even...
There was 20,000 people there and there's no way I was on the field. There's
exactly
no way I could have heard that.
What have there been changes in your opinion in America? You've been going back and forth. You've been to Sweden. You've been to Denmark. You've been to a lot of different countries.
Like Manu has touched.
Maseo, I'm sorry.
Maseo has touched upon. We too were born in America, and we all so have their rights, and we do assimilate together as well. And we have even made it all the way to the White House. Mm. But does that really change racism?
And that is the question right there. How can we, what can we do now to lessen the obstacles or say it more positively to eradicate it? What do we have to do, Nigel? What do you think? Is racism actually?
It's such a wide scope.
Exactly.
Es ist so vielschichtig, der Rassismus. Aber es ist auch sehr schwierig, das wirklich zu eliminieren, so total, weil das ja schon auch über die Geschichte und über die Familie und wie Kinder aufwachsen. Ich denke mal, ein Ansatzpunkt ist auf jeden Fall Kinder, weil die werden ja dann später das auch wieder weitertragen. Also man muss da schon im Kindergartenalter und mit Lehrern und die da weitermachen, zu sehen, dass sie einige Sachen nicht tolerieren. Zum Beispiel mein Sohn, als er in der Grundschule war, da kam er irgendwann und hat gesagt, sie spielen das Lied, das Spiel, wer hat Angst vorm schwarzen Mann? Und er fand das, also das ist ja wirklich schon alt und das wird also in dieser Zeit immer noch weitergetragen.
Yeah,
solche
Sachen. Who's afraid of the big black man? Who's afraid not only boogeyman like us, but the black man?
Es gibt also verschiedene Sachen, die auch in Schulbüchern, Rassismus in Schulbüchern, was auch letztes Jahr ein Thema war im Black History Month.
Das ist sehr wichtig. Zum Beispiel, so there's two questions here. Why is it important to continue to teach black history? And you're also trying to work on, so what I'm understanding is if you continue to teach the black history, the people of African descent and the people of because we're living in Hamburg, Germany, of German descent understand the history and what is not told in the books perpetuates racism. We had this subject also on the show briefly, and you have it here, in the school books, how racism is shown. Like you show one brown-skinned girl, and one brown-skinned girl from Africa, anywhere in Africa, and the chances of her success were so small. They said that she will have at least 6 or 7 siblings. She will only have a first level, not even a secondary education. She will probably not be able to continue higher. And then you have any other white person. She will probably only have 1 or 2 brothers and sisters. She lives in a nice house, whereas the black person, this is shown in a book. So these are the types of books that are still in our classrooms that black history touches.
Also viele Bilder werden immer reproduziert, die schon alt sind. Und das alte Denken wird dadurch immer weiter hochgehalten. Und da kann man viele Sachen verändern. Man kann ja auch sehen, dass die Kinder, die jetzt aufwachsen, für die ist es etwas anders als, sagen wir mal, 20 Jahre her. Die sind auch viel stärker in ihrer eigenen Identität verwurzelt. Und da sehen die auch, wenn die das Leben auf der Straße sehen, da sehen die professionelle Leute im täglichen Umgang, ob das jetzt Ärzte sind oder auch Politiker. So, sogar jetzt wieder bei dieser Wahl sieht man einige schwarze Politiker in Hamburg.
And we have Mike Scholars here. This is a wonderful representation of what a person of African descent can reach to be a head coach of a professional or semi-professional football team. So what he was saying is that over the years, the young people have more and more role models that they can look up to. Also in the present voting situation, we have people who are of African descent. And yeah, and the people see more and more doctors, lawyers, and everything.
So I work, you know, we have a youth team in Lübeck as well, and actually we have one of our youth players. He's his father was is an African American, and his mother is of Italian descent, and you know, I work with the youth a lot, and one of the things that I always, you know, you inadvertently hear this, they'll come to you and say, "Coach, they're mad, they're angry. Someone called me a nigger," and I'd tell them always the same thing. Well, are you a nigger?
On the team or from outside?
From the team, from several teams.
Huh?
And no, from outside.
Okay.
From in life.
Okay.
In life. No, that would not be allowed on my team.
On the team.
That would be a one-time trick, but. I'll ask him, "Are you a nigger?" Of course, that question catches them off guard, and I repeat, "Are you a nigger?" And they go, "Well, of course not." Well, then what's the problem?
Wenn ein Jugendlicher zu dir kommt und jemand hat ihm als N-Wort genannt, und dann fragst du einfach ganz klar, "Bist du eine?" Und dann erstmal ein paar Sekunden nachdenklich und
If he called you a goat. If he called you a goat, would it upset you?
Mm-hmm.
So, because you're not a goat. So if someone calls you something that you're not, we know what the definition of, it's actually a definition and dictionary of what a nigger is. You're not a lazy, shiftless, worthless person. You're a SEAL. You're one of my players. So don't let what people say that are not true annoy you.
So du arbeitest ganze Tag mit Jugendlichen und unterstützt die nächste Generation Football Players. You support the next generation of young people.
Absolutely. That's the future of any sport. It's the youth. So I'm heavily involved in.
So you would definitely say that being a professional football player, you were lucky, also talented. You got scholarships, so you didn't even have to pay to go to the university, which was great.
Well, you pay, but you pay by playing sports. But
Oh, you mean, but financially you were supported.
Yes.
Financial had a scholarship, so das war natürlich ein Vorteil für dich. Ja, schön. Und auch stolzer schwarzer Mann zu sein. Yeah.
Go ahead.
I was going to say it would be interesting for you because him being back and forth in America, we talk about the mixed relationships, for example. Mm-hmm. I asked him with our pre-interview, does he have a preference of who he'd prefer to be with when he had a partner? And he said, certainly, a woman of African descent. Mm-hmm. Of course, the goal is that it doesn't matter, you know, but... how is the tendency, would you say, does that matter for you, Manu? Do you think it's important to have same race relationships? Is there a difference?
Das Konzept, also im Deutschen kann man dieses Wort race natürlich nicht so verwenden wie im Englischen. Es ist ja viel, viel im engeren Sinn. Ich lehne das Wort ab. Also ich mag im Deutschen, also auch ich kann auf Englisch sagen, mixed oder biracial, im Deutschen geht es nicht aufgrund unserer Geschichte. Mhm. Ich denke, es ist einfach so, auch um deine Frage nochmal aufzugreifen, weil du hast vorher gefragt, so, was können wir tun, damit dieses Rassismus, ist Black History Month noch notwendig? Ich glaube, im Black History Month, warum so gerne viele Leute kommen, alle möglichen Leute mit allen möglichen Hintergrund und Optik ist, dass es auch Leute gibt mittlerweile und auch genügend weiß klassifizierte Leute. Weil im Endeffekt denke ich, man kann sagen, das sind ja alles so Klassifizierungen, schwarz, weiß und nicht wirklich Rasse. Weil das eine Möglichkeit ist, schwarze Leute irgendwie authentisch kennenzulernen. Also weil dieses Bild, das ja allgemein in Deutschland vermittelt wird oder in Büchern oder durch immer Brot für die Welt. Ne? Also, und die sagen, ich möchte einfach mal... Leute eben, ja, dann möchte ich die einfach kennenlernen, selbst, wie sie sich selbst repräsentieren als normale Leute und sind dann auch immer ganz froh, weil wir beißen nicht, egal was wir auch gegen Rassismus sagen, wir greifen niemanden an. Und das andere, denke ich, ist so, dass man, wenn man als Mann oder Frau, wenn du einen Partner suchst, dann musst du einfach bestimmte Ansprüche haben, was dieser Partner erfüllen soll. Wie die Ansprüche sind, wie das gelungen, hat auch sehr viel damit zu tun, ob man aus einem funktionalen, stabilen Familie kommt. Wenn ich die und die bestimmte Ansprüche habe, dann muss jeder die erfüllen. Ich kann nicht sagen, oh, ein schwarzer Partner sollte so sein und jemand mit asiatischen so und von einem weiß klassifizierten erwarte ich das. Aber ja, und aber auch schwarze Beziehungen gibt es hier auch viele, wo die Leute sagen, okay, die sind so unter sich, stimmt ja gar nicht. Wir haben so viele binationale, interkulturelle Beziehungen zwischen Menschen von afrikanischer Herkunft in Deutschland, weil nur weil beide irgendwie afrikanisch aussehen, heißt es nicht, sie kommen aus demselben Land.
Exactly. I like the way you address both the points. The one, first of all, why all these people come to Black History Month, whether you're a person of European descent or any other of the African descent, is because the people want to see the people of African descent authentically as they are. Whether it's someone who's written a book like Marie Nayar from her experiences, or a poet, or an athlete, or a doctor who might want to talk about something, that when you come, you see them authentically as they are, not you know, poor and not necessarily all the other so-called negative things like posters for hunger, world hunger. It's always a black person with a runny nose or something. That Black History Month shows people of African descent how they really are. You addressing, if I understood you correctly, with relationships, I really like that. Everyone has a certain preconceived idea of what a good relationship is. So you have to think about these basic important things for a relationship, whether you're from the same cultural background, where a lot of people do not want to accept the fact, of course, we realize how huge Africa is. We have, like you said, a biracial, but that means they might still be a person of African descent, a Nigerian with a Ghanaian or whatever. So, yeah, I like that. I hope we have to, we could do a talk show just about developing good relationships.
Relationships
exactly.
Among people of different backgrounds.
Wow, thank you so much. We're through with this round just about. We're talking about Black History Month and its 19th year. Nigel Asher as the organizer. Maseo, thank you for being here.
Thank you,
historian,
love.
Visual artist, you'll be there as a poet. Mike Scholar is the professional coach for the SEALs. I think you have something for me. You forgot. I saw you stick something over there. Show it to me real quick.
You know, our team colors are gold and black, and and gold is the symbol of true love, so every woman should have a black dress in her closet. So we got you
look at that. Look at that. What does that say? True love.
True love with the seals. Logo on it there.
I like that.
Yeah, that's
well, I got another
true.
Fabulous woman that I'm about to introduce. Thank you all so much for being here. Ladies and gentlemen of TV Land, thank you so much for being here by Africa Outlook.